Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wahlberger and thanks for joining me. I'm giving you some advice with respect to research mathematics in the direction of rational trigonometry and spread polynomials. So this is a continuation from my last lecture. Okay, so we've introduced the basics of rational trigonometry and now I want to fast forward to the section on the spread polynomials. So we've just finished the proof of the main laws of rational trigonometry. And now we can talk about the spread polynomials and how they arise naturally. So a good place to start is with this result, which I call the equal spreads theorem, which explains what happens if you have three lines, say L1, L2, and L3, so that the spread between L1 and L2 equals the spread between L2 and L3. So sort of like three lines, okay, emanating from some point. And the spread between these two lines, okay, equals the spread between these two lines. Let's call that common spread S. And what we're interested in is the spread between the first line and the third line. What are the possibilities for that? Okay, now in terms of a diagram, here are sort of two possibilities for that, ways of thinking about it, okay? So in this case here, they have a sort of a common intersection here, and here's the spread of S between L1 and L2, and here's the spread of S between L2 and L3. And I remark that where we put this little segment is flexible, okay? So there's two lines here, and there's actually sort of four sectors that they determine, and we could put this little line segment in any one of those four sectors. So we could also describe this spread here as also going from here to here, and or from here to here, or from here to here. Okay, so we have these two common spreads S, and then between L1 and L3, that spread between these two lines is described by this new spread R, and we're interested in the relationship between R and S. Now here's another sort of configuration that still sort of satisfies that same criterion. So here's L1 and here's L2, and they make a spread of S here. And L2 and L3 make a spread of S, and then the spread between L1 and L3 is R. Okay, and the statement is that then this spread between L1 and L3 is either zero or it's equal to 4 times s times 1 minus s. Okay, so to prove that, so suppose this spread s of L1, L3 is R, okay? Then from the triple spread formula, which tells us the relationship formed by three lines, the spreads formed by three lines, okay? So maybe it's easier to think about this here's this more obvious triangle, but in fact it works in either case. So here there are spreads of s, s, and r. So the triple spread formula will tell us then that the sum of the spreads all squared, so that's 2s plus r all squared, equals 2 times the sum of the squares of the spreads, so s squared plus r squared, or 2s squared plus r squared, plus this additional cubic term, 4 times the product of the spreads, which will be s squared r. Now if you bring everything to one side and sort of simplify things, then you'll see that this thing factors as r times r minus 4s times 1 minus s. And the reason it factors is because the solution r equals 0 is kind of obvious. That is, one possibility in this diagram is for L1 and L3 to actually coincide, say this diagram here, right? If we sort of move L3 so that it's coinciding with L1, then that will satisfy the conditions. In that case, r is equal to 0. So that's sort of an automatic solution. And then since it's a quadratic equation in r, the other solution is obtainable immediately just by a linear equation. So we get r equals 0, or r equals 4 times s times 1 minus s. Now this particular function is called the logistic map, and it plays an important role in chaos theory. Here's the graph of it. It's an inverted parabola. From 0 to 1, it goes from 0 to 1. So you can regard this, if you like, as a map from the interval 0, 1 to itself. But it's not a one-to-one map because, well, as you can see, you know, most values, there's two places where those values are taken on. So in some sense, this, what it does is sort of folds the interval over onto itself in a two-to-one fashion. And this is quite an interesting and important example in chaos theory. So it's arising here. This is actually the second spread polynomial. Okay, so more generally, well, first of all, we call this S2 of S, so that's 4 times S times 1 minus S. So that's the logistic map. So then the spread polynomial S sub n of S may be defined recursively by setting S0 of S to be 0 and S1 of S to be S. And then here is the inductive recursive rule. Sn of S equals 2 times 1 minus 2S times Sn minus S minus Sn minus 2 of S plus 2S. So it shares some of the features of something like the Chebyshev polynomials of the first or second kind, but this plus 2S is a little bit different. It makes it a little bit different. And anyway, here are some graphs of a few of them. So this will be S3, and here's S4, and here's a bunch of them, okay? And you can see that in the interval 0, 1, maps interval 0, 1 to 0, 1, they all bounce back and forth in this box in a very pleasant way, which we talked about before. Now, the connection with the triple spread formula is the following, that this recursive definition of the spread polynomials that we've defined has the property that if you take Sn minus 1 and S and Sn of S, that those three numbers for any S satisfy the triple spread formula. So this is an algebraic reflection of the fact that what this thing is measuring is, so imagine you have, say, two lines, okay, making a spread of S, and then imagine sort of reflecting this first line in the second line. So now we have a third line, okay, that's S, and that's S. Okay, and then we can keep going, you know, we can reflect this one and this one to get a fourth one. This is S, and then this is S, and then this is S. And what we're doing is we're then calculating the spread between the first and the last line. In this case, there's three equal spreads, okay? So there's going to be the connection between the S and this final spread is that it's S sub 3 of S, okay? And in general, what happens is that if you know S of n minus 1, then you know that spread, and then you add one more S, so then you get Sn. Now, there's a number of different sort of interpretations or, you know, additional formulas for Sn of S. It's a very rich kind of thing. And here in this first line, we connect with the Chebyshev polynomials, T sub n, of the first kind. Okay, I think I've told you about this one here, that it can be expressed as 1 minus T sub n of 1 minus 2S over 2. So it's an affine shift. It can also be expressed as 1 minus T sub n squared of square root of 1 minus S. And so this thing here, there seems to be an irrationality here, but yet there's no irrationality. Okay, here's another relation. Let's not talk about that one. And here's an explicit formula obtained by Shuxiang Goh and Mike Hirschhorn, former student of mine and a colleague of mine, who have also looked at these things. And they found this formula, which is expressing Sn of S as a polynomial in powers of S with certain coefficients, which are quite attractive. Some binomial coefficient there and an n over n minus k. And then we also have a generating function, which I've also mentioned to you, found also by Mike Hirschhorn. So the generating function, the ordinary generating function for Sn of S, if we write it this way here, is S times x times 1 plus x all over 1 minus x cubed plus 4sx times 1 minus x. And another formula, also found by Mike Hirschhorn, is the following, that Sn of S can be written as a sort of a binomial expansion involving one powers of 1 minus S and S, but with these sort of odd binomial coefficients, n choose 1, n choose 3, n choose 5, etc. Okay, so, you know, there's probably a lot more formulas to be found about these things. I think these spread polynomials are absolutely, really crucially important. And we're going to see a little bit more of that. Okay, so let's go to our next slide. Here we are seeing what they actually look like in terms of some lists of them. Okay, so here's sort of unfactored forms. S0 is 0, S1 is S, S2 we've already seen, that's 4S minus 4S squared, that's the logistic map. S3 is 9S minus 24S squared plus 16S cubed, which factors as S times 3 minus 4S all squared. That's actually also an important one. And here's S4 in expanded form and in factored form, S5 in expanded form, factored form, S6 also, and S7. To give you a sense of things. And I've already told you about this, but let me just reiterate, okay, that the really crucial property that these spread polynomials have, that the Chebyshev polynomials don't, is that they have a very strong factorization. So this is an observation of Shuxiang Goh when he was an honor student with me. And the observation is that Sn of S factors as a product of k dividing n, so overall factors of n, of some auxiliary polynomials, phi sub k of s. These auxiliary polynomials, we call them spread cyclotomic polynomials, or maybe just Go polynomials, phi sub 1, phi sub 2, phi sub 3, phi sub 4, here's some values of them, phi sub 5, phi sub 6, phi sub 7, and phi sub 8. And you're going to be hard-pressed to find some kind of easy, regular rule to describe what's happening with these things. So these are playing some kind of role, something like, you know, like prime numbers or something, but in a different kind of way. But so, for example, S sub 12 factors in as a product of phi sub 1, phi sub 2, phi sub 3, sub phi sub 4, phi sub 6, and phi sub 12. Phi sub 12 happens to be this thing here, and then you get this expansion here, which I think I've already shown you at some earlier point. So this is a much stronger factorization than the Chebyshev polynomials enjoy, and this is, I think, really showing clearly that sort of number theoretically, these spread polynomials are really sort of at center stage. And because the spread polynomials and the Chebyshev polynomials are only connected by an affine shift, so it's just really a question of sort of, you know, scaling them a little bit and moving them. So properties of the Chebyshev polynomials having to do with integration and extrapolation and things like that can easily be restated in terms of the spread polynomials. Okay, but it's this factorization property that makes them particularly interesting and really brings out what I think is the number theoretical context of things. So studying these phi sub k's here, I think, is a massive task that will keep people going for generations, in my view. And you can be amongst the pioneers.